In this edition of Art Loft, we dive into the creative process.
I look at it, I reinterpret it, and then I give it back transformed to my audience.
An artist reflects on how much human hands have changed the Florida environment.
Just the story of conflict as witnessed by this one particular place was really interesting.
A multimedia homage to the planet Earth.
The idea came up to maybe incorporate these rain showers with my watercolors.
The Miami City Ballet shows us how rigorously their dancers train.
And a lot of them don't realize that to see a beautiful show that they saw, it's a year of work with the frustration, the injuries.
Meet a craftsman who puts soul into every instrument he creates.
But yeah, they're hard to let go.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from the Perez Art Museum, Miami, this is Art Loft. First up tonight, we join sculptor Barbara Sorensen as she walks us through her creative process. Though Sorensen's work may vary in size and medium, the mark of the artist's hand appears in every single piece. From textured clay statues to towering aluminum structures, Sorensen's work radiates with energy befitting of the colorful Florida beach town she calls home.
Itself is about the landscape and the environment. I spend a lot of time hiking, snorkeling, biking. I spend a lot of time outdoors. And my work itself is, in the end, about change and about movement, just as the earth grows and changes. It's about what I see out there in the landscape. I look at it, I reinterpret it, and then I give it back transformed to my audience. The materials I use for creating my pieces are varied. In the beginning, I started in clay. And since then, I have moved from clay to bronze, to resins, to aluminum, to powder coated aluminum, and some various materials. My creative process, first of all, I don't do a lot of drawing ahead of time. I have a lot of ideas in my head, and I will do sketches. I'll do outlines of sketches, and so then I'll just start with the clay, and I'll have slabs, and I'll build, and I'll build, and I'll push from inside. I'll build some more. I'll use fingerprints. I do like, in clay particularly, and actually all of my materials, to let the process show. So I like the mark of the artist to show. And I think as a result, I think there's a lot of energy that's infused in the work, just subconsciously. And more, and specifically with, for example, the powder coated aluminum dwellings, the powder coated aluminum rod pieces. Again, I have some sketches. I happen to work with a master welder for that, and I cut and bend and hold the metal. But it's just an active process. We work it a little. We just start. We add parts. think that I think there's three favorite series. My goddesses are very, very important to me because I think they represented a time in my career when I finally developed my own voice as an artist. And I love the shields. The shields are my big, flat, round medallions. They've got squares, they've got hints of latches, the texture is like peeling stucco, and then the chalices. I think that would be my third one. Those directly are related to the metamorphosis of the Earth's crust for me and plate tectonics and overlapping plates. You'll see kind of a quilt work on there. Well, my Spilotheum series, being my newest series, represents for me the truest actual installation that I've done, a true total environmental piece. But basically, the Spilotheums are a big 30 by 40 foot dark cave space, and there are about 21 stalactites and stalagmites growing up from the floor and hanging from the ceiling, and some of them are 16 feet long hanging from the ceiling, and the audience has to walk among them and they feel like they're in a cave. And I'm just really excited to have that interaction of the viewer and of my work.
For more about Sorensen's work, visit BarbaraSorensen.com.
Dwayne creates the art, actually. So I have to be out there, so I'm spending a lot of time in the monsoon rains with my art pieces because I have to pull them out at the right time.
Florida has witnessed many changes in its environment, some crafted by Mother Nature and some not. From an abandoned nuclear missile site in the Everglades to deforestation, Miami artist Christy Gast's work focuses on how humans have played a major role in Florida's ever-changing environment. Take a look.
Christy Gass is a Miami-based artist, and she's taken this opportunity and worked over a year on this project that's really inspired by a disarmed nuclear missile in Everglades National Park. So part of what we do as an organization is give artists the chance to make it a real site-specific exhibition. So she's really engaged with Everglades National Park for this show, something that already exists there, but really making it her own.
The first piece that the audience encounters when they walk through the door is a video entitled War Drums that was shot in one take at dawn in one of the last stands of Slash Pine Forest, which was the native forest that originally covered a lot of Dade County. I wrote a score for two performers, two drummers, two percussionists, a conga player and a snare player. And I shot sort of one long circular take through the forest that passed by each of them individually. For this show, I was looking at the Hole in the Donut region of the Everglades, which was sort of full of these pine forests until the early 20th century when they were raised for tomato fields. They went fallow and were overgrown by Brazilian pepper. And around the same time, the military built a base there during the Cold War, and it was on high alert during the Cuban Missile Crisis. It was one of the Nike missile bases in South Florida. So I thought that just the story of conflict as witnessed by this one particular place was really interesting, and I wanted to explore that in an artwork.
So she's incorporated this handmade textile that is camouflaged with the various plants in the Everglades, plants that have changed over time because of the use of the land there. And it will overtake the gallery space in this huge sculpture that will hang from the ceiling, and viewers can come in and walk in and around and under it.
This is the largest textile sculpture that I've ever made. And I grew up in the country, and there was very little access to the arts when I was a kid, but I learned how to sew. That's what the women in my family did for a living. So it's always been a medium that I've been interested in and just kind of skilled at. And so it's always something that I go back to when I'm thinking through a project.
For more about Christy Gast and her upcoming exhibitions, visit ChristyGast.com.
Built especially for dancers. From 3 years old all the way till 19 years old, we have classes in ballet, modern, and jazz.
Inspired by desert monsoon rains, artist Sybil Shagard's Redford seeks to expand audiences' environmental consciousness through music, dancing, watercolors, and film. Multimedia exhibition, The Way of the Rain Miami, is a tribute to our planet and also Redford's directorial debut.
I was invited by Paul Lehr of Young Arts to bring The Way of the Rain Miami to Miami. And this project is a multimedia art performance piece in collaboration with music, dance, film. And it is an homage to our planet Earth and its universal elements. I have been working with watercolor for quite some time, and my studio in New Mexico is located on a high plateau, on a high desert plateau outside of Santa Fe, New Mexico. And so during the summer months, we have the monsoon rains, which are extremely attractive. And the idea came up to maybe incorporate these rain showers with my watercolors. So I reversed the technique, and on dry paper, I applied the watercolor. And then I take these pieces of watercolor paper out into the rain showers, and the rain creates the art, actually. So I have to be out there, so I'm spending a lot of time in the monsoon rains with my art pieces because I have to pull them out at the right time to make sure they're not rained out. I decided I wanted to create a statement to pinpoint on this issue. And I figured that if I really want to create a strong voice, I should invite some other artists with diverse to be part of this. And since dance music is my passion, my other passion, I decided to include music and dance and film to create just a bigger voice, to just be more thoughtful of where we are and what is happening to our Earth. For the audience, I'm hoping that they experience something they have never seen before because of all these different elements of different art forms, bringing that together. But also the projections, the lighting done by Steve Cohen. He created some really powerful messages on top of these silks that I'm showing. So it's going to be remarkable. And I think, I'm hoping that people leave and become more open, conscious, that their consciousness will open up, and hopefully they won't forget so fast. And hopefully when the next rain shower comes down, they might think, oh, I remember The Way of the Rain. Here is The Way of the Rain.
For more information about The Way of the Rain, visit youngarts.org.
I never was into custom-made guitars, but for this one, I had to have it.
The Miami City Ballet has been a well-established dance company in South Florida for years, enriching the arts community and its youth. Their intensive training classes have not only produced top dance professionals, but also confident, driven young adults.
We're on Miami Beach, which is really wonderful, built especially for dancers. From 3 years old all the way till 19 years old, we have classes in ballet, modern, and jazz, all kinds of dance classes. The top levels in the school are part of what we call a pre-professional division, which means these are serious dance students, both male and female, that are vying to get a position in this company or another professional company around the country or the world. And they're training 6 days a week, very intense.
People don't realize how difficult ballet is. You know, we work very hard. People a lot of time just come to see the show, and a lot of them don't realize that to see a beautiful show like they saw, it's a year of work with the frustration, the injuries, and all those things that happen.
Working at it every day, it's definitely something like, sometimes we put it all the tension in our face and we're like looking at ourselves in the mirror, like, this is so hard, but then you have to just look like a beautiful ballerina and make it look easy, and that takes a lot of practice to get to that point.
The wonderful thing about classical ballet training is it prepares a child for any career they pursue because it teaches them discipline, self-esteem, an incredible work ethic. They learn time management, they learn respect for their peers and their teachers and their directors.
Well, you have to be disciplined to be a ballerina, because you sit there and you do the same thing every day, even though you think about different things every day, but you do the same thing every day, and that takes a lot of, like, it's kind of a mind game, I think. So being out in the real world, anything you do, being a ballerina, even if you're sitting at a desk all day, like, you've been through that mind game and you push yourself every day, and I think that helped me in any job in the future.
We are so committed to creating a strong male dance program. So we have scholarships that we offer to young boys ages 7, 8, 9, 10 years old who haven't had any training before. They come and audition, and if they show a proclivity for dance and movement, musicality, you know, a flair for performance, then we bring them on board and we train them.
The athletic part of the competition, I think, is a big boost for men. You know, when they are in the class and they see that, you know, friends are pushing and turning more and jumping higher. There is a nice, healthy competition with men.
We're so pleased to have some of the best instructors in the world here teaching these students. And the South Florida community should feel so proud to have such an incredible training program right here on Miami Beach, producing these beautiful young dancers that are going on to professional careers.
For more information about the Miami City Ballet, their school, and upcoming performances, visit miamicityballet.org.
The idea of plot making, or the idea of plot, both references storytelling in the case of Baraka, but it also references place.
In closing tonight, we learn how to make a guitar really play. Sure, it takes a talented musician, but behind every good guitar player is a skilled craftsman, or at least that's what John Hill would say. The Cleveland-based woodworker crafts only the finest instruments, and in this segment, he explains how his guitars set customers apart.
I was one of those people where I just loved the wood shop. When I started building guitars, this was in like 83 or 84, and it was a lot of handwork, files and rasps and belt sanders, and I found out early that I kind of had a knack for that stuff, and I started playing guitar, getting interested in guitar, and obviously guitars are made out of wood, so I just kind of thought that I could sort of build my own guitar, and so that's really where it started for me, high school. People that don't play guitar, that build guitars, I don't know how they can do it. I'm just not a great musician where I can just jump up on stage and just hold my own, but I try and play enough to where I understand all the idiosyncrasies that these guys want at a high level.
I never was into custom-made guitars, but for this one, I had to have it. The guitar was so beautiful, and the neck was so thin and fast, and the action was like a runway, you know. I mean, I was just like, I couldn't stop shredding at it. I just couldn't put it down.
The form always follows function. I believe in that rule 100%. Like, it has to work as an instrument when it's done. You know, I always visualize everything in my head. You know, I kind of see how it's going to transform into what its final thing is going to be. I would start out with a piece of paper that's big enough for a whole guitar, and I would just strike a center line and take another guitar and kind of trace it and get the basic width elements, so, you know, the width and the length, and I just sort of start filling in all those pieces of the puzzle until I get it the way I want it to really look, and then I'll transfer all those final curves and drawings, I'll scan it, and then I'll bring it into like a CAD program, engineer it. So after the CNC machine cuts the parts out, CNC stands for Computer Numeric Control, and that just means it's a router head that's controlled by a computer. I have it doing fretboard radiuses, like fret slots, neck shapes. We do have to
sand those parts, there's machine marks in them, or, you know, like some of the wood could chip off, you know, when the bodies and necks are finish sanded, and then they go to paint. And then the hardware elements, the hardware is like the bridge, the tuning keys, the knobs, the jack plate, things like that, the pickups. Our guitars are different because of the way that they're assembled and set up, where it's a kind of a spiritual thing for me in a way, you know. But I'll clean my workbench off and I'll lay out all the parts like really neat, and you know, with the neck and the body and everything ready to go, and I'll take a picture of it, you know, and I'll send it to the guy and I'll say, hey, I'm starting to assemble your guitar.
He takes a real lot of care into hand making these things from the ground up, every aspect of the guitar. And that's what they used to do in the old days at all the famous guitar companies that we know. Now they just mass producing them so much with machines. It's beautiful. I mean, as far as cosmetically. But if you pick it up, it's really nothing like the ones that were made back in the old days.
Take care of that.
You know, so each guitar he develops or has an idea to make, it is absolutely made, you know, from the ground up, you know, with every little detail, okay, just right. I mean, he knows exactly what he's doing.
So the assembly process for me lately has been the final chapter in like mastering what the whole guitar is about. Guitars, when they're set up well, people that really have an ear for sound qualities, they appreciate it more.
There are some guitars that are inspirational to someone. You pick them up and all of a sudden you just know, like, oh my God, this is something that, you know, I can't put it down. It's giving me more ideas. It's inspiring me to go farther to another step.
Motivates them to like write or just be creative. They can like, wow, this really sounds magical. And like, you know, I kind of, let me play this chord and let me like try this thing and let me play through this amp. And the next thing that you know, they're creating music, they're playing music, they're, that's where it's all about for me. So I really think that the music in general is what I try and strive for, is just to make it a musical instrument so that people will want to play it, want to write with it, want to show it to people. I'd like to keep them for about a week after we actually finish the assembly process. Then I play them, I tweak them, just dial them in a little bit. But yeah, they're hard to let go. Like a, you know, if your dog has puppies or something, you got to give all the puppies away, right? It's tough.
On Hill's work, visit bootlegguitars.com. Thanks so much for joining us this week. Remember, you can always visit wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. Also, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at artloftffl. I'm Kaylin James reminding you to stay creative. Bye. Loft. Now it's your turn. Oh, okay. You know, I can't hear it, so I'm like, cheese. Yeah, you like that, huh? Hey, everybody messed up. Inspired by Mr. Babadook. Babadook. That was his thing. Babadook, Duke, Duke. Safety, it's safe time. Yeah, here we go. Do not chop off my fro, please. Why do I get all this weave put in this week? Oh, yeah, yeah. I'll never get through this one. Bam, and take it. out of here.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.